through his curiosity. As long as the spirit is active in a physical body, it cannot work in its true form as spirit. It can only shine through the veil of physical existence, so to speak. In reality, our human godlike belongs to the spiritual world, but as it appears within our physical existence, its true form is veiled. We might also say that the thought activity of physical human beings is a shadowy image, a reflection of the true spiritual being to which it belongs. During physical life, the spirit interacts with the earthly material both by using a material body as its basis. It is true that one of the tasks of the human spirit, as long as this spirit is proceeding from incarnation to incarnation, is to work in the physical world, but this task could not be completed appropriately if the spirit is only in the body existence. The intentions and goals of an earthly task are no more worked out and determined within an earthly incarnation than the blueprint for a building comes about on the site where the builders are already at work. The plan for the building is worked out in the architect's office, and the goals and intentions of earthly endeavor are developed in the country of spirits, where each human spirit must dwell again and again between incarnations in order to equip itself for work in a physical lifetime. The architect draws up the plan for a house in the office, according to architectural and other standards, and does this without touching actual bricks and mortar. Similarly, the architect of human creativity, the spirit or higher self, develops the necessary goals and capabilities according to the laws of the country of spirit beings, in order to then send them into the Decree Rules 133. Earthly world. Only by returning again and again to its own realm will a human spirit be able to bring the spirit into the earthly world by means of its physical material instrument. In the physical arena, we learn to know the characteristics and forces of the physical world. While working, we gather experience about what the physical world requires of those who want to work in it. We also learn to know the characteristics of the matter we intend to use to embody our thoughts and ideas, although these ideas and thoughts themselves cannot be derived from matter. Thus the physical world is the setting for both work and learning. Afterwards, in spirit country, what has been learned is transformed into the active abilities and capacities of the human spirit. To make things clearer, the comparison we used above can be taken further. An architect works out a design for a house, and this plan is carried out. In the process, the architect gains experience in a number of ways so that his or her capabilities are enhanced. When the next design has to be drawn up, all these experiences flow into it. The second design is enriched by everything learned in the process of carrying out the first. It is the same with successive human lifetimes. In the intervals between incarnations, the spirit is at home in its own realm and is able to devote itself totally to the requirements of spiritual life. Released from physical existence, it develops in all directions and incorporates the fruits of its experience in previous lifetimes into this process. Its attention is thus always directed to the earthly context of its past. 134 Theosophy. The extent and emergence of spirits into action, the spirit is constantly working to keep pace with the earth's evolution, and is working on itself so that in each incarnation the service it performs corresponds to the earth's situation at that time. Of course, this is only a very general picture of successive human lifetimes. Reality never conforms totally to this picture but only approximates it. Circumstances indicate that a person's next life is much less perfect than the preceding one, but on the whole the irregularities are balanced out against the life limits and successive incarnations. 44. The course of our spirit's development in the country of spirit beings takes place through our becoming fully involved in the life of each of its different regions. Our own life evolves into each region in succession, temporarily assume the characteristics of each of these regions. As a result, their being permeates our being so that we are strengthened in our work onward. In the first region of the country of spirit beings, we are surrounded by the spiritual archetypes of earthly things. During an earthly lifetime, we only learn to know the shadows of these archetypes, which we grasp in our own thoughts. What is merely thought on earth is experienced in this region. aware of our own physical, bodily nature, from which we now feel quite relieved, and experience only our spiritual being as actually belonging to us. When we do become aware, as is in memory, of the body we have laid aside, we see it no longer as a physical being but rather as a thought being, and know the fact that it belongs to the outer world becomes a direct observation. We learn to regard it as something belonging to the outer world, as an extension of the outer world. As a result, we no longer consider our own physical existence to be more closely related to ourselves, and we cease to separate it from the rest of the world. We experience the entire outer world, including our own physical embodiment, as a unity. Our personal physical embodiments merge into a unity with the rest of the world. At this stage, we view the archetypes of physical, bodily reality as a unity to between ourselves once we long. Through observation, we gradually learn to recognize our relationship to, our unity with, our surroundings, to realize that we ourselves once were what is spread out around us here. This is one of the fundamental ideas of ancient Indian Vedic wisdom. The sage acquires during earthly life. 136 Philosophy. What other people experience only after death, namely the ability to grasp the thought that we ourselves are related to all things, the thought, that is you. In earthly life this is an ideal that our thinking can aspire to, but in the country of spirit beings it is an immediate fact that becomes ever clearer as we gain spiritual experience. We become ever more aware that, in our essential being, we belong to the spiritual world. We perceive ourselves as spirits among spirits, as organs of the primal spirits. We feel in ourselves their word, I am the primal spirit, or, in terms of Vedic wisdom, I am Brahman, that is, I am part of, an organ of, the primal being from which all beings spring. Thus we see that what we grasp during earthly life is a shadowy idea and the object of all wisdom's aspiration is a matter of direct experience in the spirit world. This idea can be got during earthly life only because it is an actual fact of spiritual existence. 45. During spiritual existence, we see the relationships and circumstances that surround us during earthly life from a more elevated vantage point, as if from outside. While we live in the spirit country's lowest region, this is how we relate to earthly circumstances having to be directly with physical, bodily reality. We are born on earth into a family and an ethnic group, and we live in a particular country. All these circumstances determine our earthly existence. We find that the circumstances in the physical world cause us to become friends with particular people or to pursue a particular line of work, and we determine the general character of our life. In the first region of us, the three worlds 137. Country of spirit being, all this comprises of the living thought entity. In a certain sense, we live through it all again, but from the active spiritual side. Our love for our family and the friendship we extended to others are now enlivened in us from within, and our capacities in this direction are enhanced. What works in the human spirit is the force of love of family and friends is strengthened, and in this respect, we later enter earthly existence as more protected human beings. For the most part, our daily relationships and earthly life are what ripen into fruit in this most region of the country of spirit beings. The aspect of the human being that in its interest is fully bound up with his daily circumstances will feel related to this region for the greatest portion of the spiritual life between incarnations. The deeper we feel related to the physical world are encountered again in the spiritual world. Just as everything that the soul once possessed through the physical body falls away, so does the bond that once linked soul to soul and physical life free itself from the circumstances that only had meaning and reality in the physical world. To put one soul within another in physical life lives on after death, lives on in the spiritual world. Of course, words going to describe physical circumstances can only inexactly express what takes place in the spiritual world. Speaking of physical accounts, however, it is certainly correct to say that souls who belong together during physical life meet again in the spiritual world and continue their lives together under the circumstances of that world. 138 Theosophy. The next region is the one in which the mind that is common to the thought being of the entire earthly world grows and springs as a fluid element of the spiritual world, so to speak. As long as we are observing the world from the vantage point of physical embodiment, life appears down to individual living things. In the country of spirit beings, however, life is released from individual things and flows throughout like the blood of life, as a living unity that is present in all things. During earthly life we get only a glimmer or a reflection of this, which is expressed in any devotion we bring toward the whole, toward the unity and harmony of the world. All religious life derives from this reflection, making us aware of the extent to which the comprehensive meaning of existence does not lie in anything individual and transitory. We come to regard transitory existence as an image or likeness of something eternal, of a harmonious whole, and we move up to this unity reverently and worshipfully in performing our religious rituals. In the country of spirit being, however, living thought nature appears in its true form rather than as a reflection, and we can actually unite with the unity we worship on earth. Our religious life and everything related to it bears fruit in this region. Here, spiritual experience teaches us that our individual destinies cannot be separated from the community to which we belong, and the ability to recognize ourselves as parts of a whole develops. Religious feeling and everything in its struggle for clear and noble morality during our lifetime will draw strength from this season during the greater part of the interval we spend in. The three globes 139. And we are then re-embodied with our abilities enhanced in this regard. In the first region, we were in the company of the souls that either were most closely linked to the physical world in our previous lifetime. In the second region, we come into the presence of all those who truly felt united in a wider sense through a common devotion, a common faith, and so on. It must be emphasized that our spiritual experiences in preceding regions continue in the next, so we are not torn out of the context of family, friends, and so on when we take part in the life of the second and successive regions. The regions of the country of spirit beings are not separate departments, they interpenetrate each other. We experience being in a new region not because we have entered it in any outward way, but because we have only now acquired the inner ability to perceive something that has been surrounding us all the time. Of spirit beings contains the archetypes of the soul world. Everything that lives in that world is present here as a living thought being. We find here the archetypes of desires, wishes, emotions, and so on. But no self-seeking clings to the soul here in the spirit world. Just as all life constitutes a unity in the second region, all desires, wishes, pleasures, and displeasures form a unity in this third region, so that what others wish and desire is indistinguishable from what I wish and desire. The sensations and feelings of all beings form a common world that encloses and surrounds everything else, like the air that surrounds the earth. This region is Situ 46, 47, 140 Theosophy. The atmosphere of the country of spirit beings. Everything done during earthly life is a service of the common good and in selfless devotion to our fellow human beings who bear fruit here in this third region, because by living in service and devotion we were already living in its reflection. Humankind's great benefactors, the rooted individuals who perform great services for their communities, acquired their ability to do so in this region after having prepared themselves for a special relationship to it in earlier lifetimes. 48. Obviously, the three regions of spirit country that have been described so far relate in a particular way to the worlds below, to the physical and soul worlds, in that they contain the archetypes of living thought beings that assume physical or soul existence in the other two worlds. The fourth region is the first that is pure spirit country, although not in the fullest sense of the word. It differs from the three lower regions in that they contain the archetypes of things and beings we find as given before we ourselves intervene in these worlds. Our everyday life on earth is related to these transient things, which, however, direct our attention to their basis in eternity. These transient things, and also our fellow creatures to whom we turn our selfless attention, are not there because of us. But what is in the world because of us is everything created through the arts and sciences, through technology, the state and so on, everything we incorporate into the world is original works of our spirit. Without our participation, no image of these things would exist in the world. The archetypes for these purely. The three worlds 141. Human creations are to be found in the fourth region of the country of spirit beings. Everything human beings develop during earthly life by way of scientific accomplishments, artistic ideas and forms, and technological thinking bears fruit in this fourth region. Artists, scholars and great inventors draw their impulses from this region during their stay in the spirit world, and here their genius is enhanced so that during later incarnations they can contribute still more to the further development of our civilization. But we must not imagine that this fourth region is of significance for outstanding individuals only. It is of significance for all of us. Any concerns during physical life that we spent an interval between death and a new birth without passing through this region, in the next life we would have no interest reaching beyond the narrow circumference of our own personal life to universal human concerns. As it has just been said, not even this region can be called pure spirit country, in the fullest sense of the word, which is the condition in which we have left in Earth's cultural development place into our spiritual existence in this region. We can enjoy only the fruits of whatever our own talents and the degree of development of our ethnic group, creation and so on have allowed us to achieve. In the still higher regions of the country of spirit beings, the human spirit is relieved of all earthly bonds and ascends to a certain spiritual world where it experiences the 49, 142 theosophy. Intentions and goals it established for earthly life. Everything that is actually achieved in the world brings the highest goals and intentions into existence only in the form of a relatively human topic. Every crystal, every tree, every animal, and also everything we accomplish through our own creativity, often provide only copies of what the spirit intended. During our incarnation, all we can do is link up and see perfect copies of perfect intentions and goals. We ourselves can only be copies or imitations of what the kingdom of the spirit intended us to be. Therefore, all the actual here is spirits in the country of spirit beings who only have the choice to be connected to this region of spirit country for any interval between two incarnations. Here we are really ourselves, we are what is true about our existence in our various incarnations. In this region our true human self, the self that appears in you in each incarnation, even comes its own expression. Since it brings with it abilities that have matured in the spirit most lower regions, it carries the fruits of living your lifetimes over into succeeding ones. When the self is in the fifth region of the country of spirit beings, it dwells in the kingdom of intentions and goals. In the fifth region, like an architect who learns from imperfections that have become evident as new tools and later designs only what he or she has been able to perfect, the self discards any of the results of experience in earlier lifetimes that have to do with lower worldly imperfections. It is now at home with the intentions of the country of spirit beings and crushes by them. The three worlds 143. With the results of earlier lifetimes. Clearly, the strength that can be drawn from this region depends on the extent to which the embodied self has achieved results that are fit to be taken up into the world of intentions. A self that has attempted to realize the intentions of the spirit by means of its active thought life or wise and loving work during earthly life will be a good candidate for this region. On the other hand, nothing that is totally given over to mundane circumstances, nothing that dwells on an intransitory thing, can prove to be capable of playing any role in the purposes of the eternal order of the world. Only those few things that have had an effect extending beyond everyday interests can develop into fruit in these upper regions of the country of spirit beings. However, we must not imagine that boasting renown or any such thing is what is meant here. It is rather a question of anything, even in the most restricted life situation, that leads to an awareness of each single thing's importance to the eternal progressive course of existence. In this region, we must become accustomed to accepting things differently than we are able to do in physical life. For instance, if we have acquired very little that we need to this deep region, we feel in order to need to imprint on ourselves an input that will cause our next life to run its course in such a way that the effect of this deficit becomes apparent in the destiny or karma we need. The unfortunate fate, to put it in terms of that lifetime, that meets us there, and that may even provoke bitter complaining, appears in the fifth region is exactly what we need. Since in this fifth region we are dwelling in our true self, we are 144 Theosophy. Raised above everything lower worldly that enveloped us during our incarnation. Here, we are what we always have been and always will be in the course of our incarnation. We are living under the authority of the intentions that exist in each incarnation, intentions that we incorporate into our own self. That is, we look back on our past and are aware that everything we have experienced is being absorbed into intentions that we will have to realize in future. A certain capacity to remember earlier lifetimes as well as a prophetic preview of later ones flares up. We know that what this book calls the spirit self, to the extent that it is already developed, is in its own element in this region, where it continues to develop and prepares itself to be able to fulfill spiritual intentions and earthly reality in a new incarnation. 51. If, through a series of sojourns in the country of spirit beings, this spirit self has developed now. Life in the spirit becomes as familiar to us life in physical reality as to earthly human beings. At this stage of development, the viewpoint of the spiritual world begins to prevail as the one the self chooses more or less consciously as the standard for his earthly lives to come. It feels itself to be a member of the world's divine order, and the laws and limitations of earthly life do not touch its innermost being. The strength needed for everything that is carried out comes from the spiritual world. But this spiritual world is a unity, and those who live in it know that the eternal has worked to create the past. We are also able to determine. The dream world 145. Their future direction in accordance with the eternal, their view, once restricted to the past, has expanded and become perfect point 9 human beings who have reached this level provide for themselves the goals they are to achieve in their next incarnation. Working out of a country of spirit beings, such human beings influence their own future so that it proceeds in line with what is true and spiritual. Because they have climbed to the level where they can understand divine wisdom, these human beings spend the intervals between incarnations in the presence of all the exalted beings who have an unrestricted view of that wisdom. 9. The statement that achieved they are also able to determine their future direction in accordance with the eternal is intended to point to the special character of the soul's constitution during the time between death and a new birth. By the standards of life in the physical world, the stroke of destiny in the life of an individual may seem to be in direct conflict with what that person wants and intends. During life between death and birth, however, a rule life force that prevails in the human soul points the way for the person in question to experience the very glow of faith. The soul perceives, as it were, an imperfection pre-existing in previous earthly lives as a result of some ugly deed or thought. During the interval between death and birth, a womb-like impulse that arises in the soul urges it to balance out this imperfection. As a result, the soul acquires the tendency to plunge into some misfortune in its subsequent earthly life, something it must suffer in order to restore equilibrium. Once it has been born into a physical body and hit by this stroke of destiny, the soul in question has no inkling that in its pre-birth life in the spirit it had actively pushed itself in the direction of this hard gate. But in actual fact, as unwished for and unintended as this flow may seem from the viewpoint of earthly life, the soul has willed it upon itself in the course of its supersensible existence. Out of eternity, human beings determine their future. 146 Theosophy. In the sixth region of the country of spirit beings, everything that human beings do brings about what is best suited to the true and essential nature of the world. Human beings can no longer seek what is to their own advantage, but only what should happen according to the proper progression of the world order. The seventh region of the spirit world leads to the boundary of the three worlds we have discussed. Here, human beings stand face to face with the kernels of life that are transplanted from still higher worlds into these three where they will complete their task. Having arrived at the limits of the three worlds, human beings recognize themselves in their own kernels of life. This means that the riddles of these three worlds have been solved for them, they have acquired a full liberty of the life in these worlds. Under ordinary circumstances and physical life, the soul faculties by which we experience the spiritual world in a way that strives here do not become conscious. We work in unconscious depths on the physical organs to bring about consciousness in the physical world, but thus they remain imperceptible as far as this world is concerned. An eye, too, is incapable of seeing itself because the forces that make it possible to see other things are broken in. If we want to assess the extent to which a human life between birth and death is the result of earlier earthly lives, we must take into account the fact that a vantage point situated within this life itself does not allow us to do so. From this point of view, an earthly life might appear to be imperfect, full of suffering and so on, while from a point of view based outside earthly life, we form this life. The three worlds 147. The sins in all its suffering and imperfection was proved to be the consequence of earlier lives. By setting out on the path to knowledge as it is described in a subsequent chapter of this book, the soul can free itself from the circumstances of bodily life and perceive an image of the experience as it undergoes between death and a new birth. This type of perception makes it possible to depict the process of taking place in the spirit world, as has been done here in a sketchy form. Only when you remember that the soul's entire constitution is different in the physical body than it is when it is undergoing purely spiritual experiences, can you see these positions in the right light. See, the physical world and its connection to the worlds of souls and spirits. The formations of the soul and spirit world cannot be the object of outer sensory perception. Such perceptible objects must be reckoned as a third mode alongside the other two. During bodily existence, we live in all three worlds at once. We perceive the objects of the sense perceptible world and work on them. Soul structures work on us through their forces of sympathy and antipathy, while we ourselves stir up waves in the soul world with our likes and dislikes, wishes and desires. The spiritual nature of things, however, is reflected in our God world, and as thinking spirit beings we are citizens of the country of spirit beings and comrades of everything that lives in this realm. 52. 148 Theosophy. This makes it clear that the sense perceptible world is only part of what surrounds us. It is distinct from, and to a certain extent independent of, our overall surroundings simply because it can be perceived with senses that disregard the soul and spiritual aspects of these surroundings. It is like a piece of ice floating on water. The ice consists of the same substance as the surrounding water but stands out because of certain qualities it possesses. In the same way, sense perceptible things are of the same substance as the soul and spirit world surrounding them, but they stand out because of certain characteristics that make them perceptible to our senses. To put it somewhat figuratively, they are condensed spirit and soul formations, and the condensation makes it possible for our senses to acquire knowledge about them. Ice is just one of the manifestations of water, and sense perceptible things are just one form in which soul and spirit beings exist. Having grasped this, we can also understand that the spirit world can change into the soul world and the soul world into the sensory world, just as water can turn tide. 53. From this perspective, it also becomes clear why the human beings are able to think thoughts about sense-perceptible things. Every thinking person must ask the question, what is the relationship of my thoughts about a stone to the stone itself? For people who are able to look into nature especially deeply, this question appears clearly to their mind's eye. They experience the world of human thoughts as being in harmony with the structure and order of nature. Kepler, the famous astronomer, put it very beautifully. The three worlds 149. The truth is that the divine calling that bids us study astronomy is inscribed on the world itself, not in words and syllables.